Meg, it's great to be back with this wonderful series. Thanks everyone for coming out. And I paid extra to have the microphone set up just to... Terrible microphone, what it is. I'm going to read from fairly early in the Children's Crusade, so I don't need to set up a lot. It's a story about a family in Potomac Valley, set over the course of 5 decades. And this is early on, sort of mid-70s. As far as impulse goes, I think there's nothing quite like the impulsivity of a five-year-old. So I'll just start here. James started kindergarten on the hottest September day in recorded history. At 7:30 in the morning, it was already 92 degrees outside. "I stay inside when it's hot," he said at breakfast, attempting to bolster the case he'd been making for several days, that he shouldn't go to school this year after all. At bedtime the night before, his father had told him that on his own first day of school, back in 1934, he had been so reluctant that his sister had been forced to take him by the hand and pull him along. The heels of his new shoes were worn down. He dragged his feet so hard. James usually liked stories about his father's childhood mistakes, but this one didn't help. His teacher, a Miss McKinley, was new to the school. When the bell rang, she waved off the mothers and invited her charges to sit cross-legged at the front of the room on a large square of indoor-outdoor carpeting strewn with paper cutouts of the letters of the alphabet. James sat on the letter F and felt it crinkle under his bottom. He stood up, sat down, and felt it crinkle again. He got to his feet and said in a loud voice, "My pho is wrinkling." The teacher's back was turned and she didn't respond. "Teacher, my pho is wrinkling." The other boys and girls were sitting with their hands in their laps as the teacher had asked. She turned and looked down at James. He had a paper name tag hanging from a piece of yarn around his neck. And she peered at it and said, "James, that is not a pho, that is an F. And we're big boys and girls now. We stay seated until we are told we may get up." Then she smiled a dazzling smile, her teeth bright as chiclets. And in that instant, he fell in love. At home that evening, all four Blair children were hot and tired. Their father had made his special first day of school dinner, barbecued spare ribs and corn on the cob, but the children only poked at their food. At her end of the table, their mother gazed off into the distance and took occasional sips of her iced tea. "I guess," their father said, "we may have some spare ribs this evening." "Ha," Rebecca said, "I get it." Robert got it too, but he wasn't going to say so in his second. Instead, he drained his lemonade and said, "I'm not that hungry, but I'm incredibly thirsty." Rebecca gave him a long look. "What?" "Let's hope you're not dehydrated." "Why would I be dehydrated?" "You've probably been sweating a lot from the heat." Bill pressed his napkin to his lips. He'd been on call the night before, and a febrile infant had necessitated a trip to the hospital. He was very tired, no longer able to recover from sleep deprivation as easily as he had in the past. He said, "Do you children know how to tell if you're dehydrated?" They were silent for a moment. "Your urine is very concentrated," Rebecca said decisively. "It's dark yellow. Look, here's a trick." He held out his arm and pinched the skin on the back of his hand. "If your skin holds the pinch, you need fluids." All four children pinched themselves and then repeated the test to be sure. "I'm not dehydrated," Rebecca said. "I'm not either," Ryan said. "We're all healthy," their father said. "Hot, but healthy. Now, I want to hear about school. How was the first day?" At the sound of this question, their mother returned her attention to the table. "Heaven," she said. Their father held her gaze, unblinking, keeping everything in reserve. She glanced at him and then looked away. Robert and Rebecca were accustomed to this kind of muted confrontation and coped by briefly suspending their feelings, as if feelings were objects unruled by gravity, capable of floating in the air until they were claimed again. James was not yet aware of his parents' difficulties. It was hard. hardest for Ryan. Dad, he said. Yes, Ryan. I didn't have school. I don't start till next week. I know that, honey. I should have said I wanted to hear about school or not school, as the case may be. I think it's funny, Rebecca said, when you say, as the case may be, because case, get it? You're a doctor. You have cases. So do lawyers, Rob said. I have a patient, but I try not to think of them as cases. Penny looked at her husband, sitting at the opposite end of the table, so straight and tall. This kind of comment generally annoyed her. Bill the paragon, Bill the saint. But because the day had been heaven, her objection occurred at a lower register than usual and faded away. Since James's birth, she'd been overwhelmed by the children, by James, really. But today had been lovely, and once Ryan started back to school, her time would be her own. She was almost 40, ready to start a new chapter of her life. During the family's recent week at Sea Ranch, she'd gathered dozens of shells from the beach and was planning to decorate something with them. And she had a new 5-pound bag of clay and some colored wax for making sand candles. She could hardly wait to get started. James, Bill said, you first. How was it? Bill and James had already had 2 or 3 brief but charged conversations about James's morning, during which Bill had gotten bursts of story. But it was his practice to make sure everyone had a few uninterrupted minutes at the dinner table to talk about the day or anything else. And he waited for James to begin. Her name, James said, is Miss McKinley. Robert snorted and then tried to cover it up with a cough. He wasn't worried about James's feelings so much as his own reputation as a teenager, which he was half a year away from becoming. A teenager would have better things to do than make fun of his little brother, his little 5-year-old kindergarten brother. He had to remember who he really was. You liked her, Bill said. My letter wrinkled, James said. I sat on it and it wrinkled. I got an F. Anna, Robert said. And I highly doubt you got a grade for your first day of kindergarten. No, James said. F like A, B, C, D, E, F, G. He began singing the alphabet song. Okay, okay, Robert said. We get it. Let's let James finish, Bill said. I painted at the easel, James said. I went on the slide and got burned. I'll bet that metal slide was hot, Bill said. We had juice, James said. 1 cup, Miss Kinley said. Miss McKinley said there was water if we wanted more. Is she nice? Ryan asked, wanting for his brother all the sweetness of his own school life. James had been holding a spare rib, and he set it down. His hands were covered with barbecue sauce, and he flung them wide and said, she is my queen.